Hello, I'm Julia. I work as a planner in Forsman & Bodenfors, like a small creative shop up north, up until recently. I work as a planner there. I've been with Forsman for 2 years, and like Chris said, today I'm going to talk a little bit about the way we find our chaos in our everyday work and whatever tools and rules that we have to infuse that chaos that we call tillsammans, or the way we collaborate. Let's see if this clicker doesn't seem to work either, actually. So, yeah, sorry. Maybe now? So hello. Yeah. So up until recently, Forsman & Bodenfors was a small creative shop up north, 2 offices. We were founded in Gothenburg 30 years ago. But a couple of weeks back, something exciting happened to us that Neil talked a little bit about. We merged with an RD agency called KBS. But I will show you a quick film instead of talking about it. Well, this is, of course, very exciting, going from around 200 to being over 1,000 people. We're now facing a little bit of a challenge because we're built around a culture rather than a process. We don't have a book that you're given when you come into Forsman that tells you how to work or how to do things. You have to be part of the culture to understand how we work. And now that we have lots of new exciting possibilities and lots of new exciting offices, we're going to have to help each other to be part of this culture more than ever before. So while it's all very exciting, we've been having lots of conversations around how we work, what it means to have a culture that is built around tillsammans, as we call it, how that works for creativity, but also what's difficult about it and how we can help people get into it more easily. And tillsammans for us, we don't call it collaboration because it's a lot more than that, and that's what I'm going to talk about today. It's a way of organizing ourselves, it's a way of talking to each other, it's a way of working with clients, so it's a lot more than just collaboration. And it's something that we believe actually rewires the creative process and helps create work that resonates with people. But I will go through how we do it internally, and hopefully I can inspire some of you today with that. So at the base of working tillsammans is a strong belief that back in the days, we were competing, but humans collaborate. So it's a very simple principle to build an organization on, that more brains are essentially better than one, and if we help each other, the work will be better. That's the foundation of the whole culture and what we're built on. And normally, agencies and companies are structured like this. My background is in an agency that is structured like this, which is not really weird. It's top-down, it's easy to understand. You have someone at the top leading everything, leading the work, leading the agency. It's traditional, that's how it looks. And you have agencies who mirror the client's organizations in the same way. So you have senior people talking to senior people, and you have junior people talking to junior people. Nothing weird about that, except for when you come into Forsman. So when we try to describe our organization and how we're modeled, we ended up with the word blob, which might seem a little bit unstructured, but it's the closest thing we could come to the truth. So essentially, we are this huge, like, molded blob that floats around, and then we break out into smaller teams, and that's how the agency is structured. So there is no structure, it's completely flat. And what that means, I will go into a little bit later. But also, it has an effect on the way we work. So I know we've been talking a little bit about the creative process and how it looks and how it usually works. This is familiar for everyone. This is how I worked in my previous workspace. It was really comfortable, especially being a planner, where you have your kind of responsibility area with the strategy and creative brief. You do your work, you do your pre-work, you get it signed off, and then you can hand it over and kind of watch it go fly by itself. But it's a linear process. And in our culture, we have a belief that if you're to produce work that resonates with humans, you need to allow yourself to be human. And this process isn't human. It's linear. It's not how the human mind works. The human mind is more like this. I think Neil talked about it a little bit too. It's a chaos. It goes in all directions, and you need to let it. So not only is our process one of chaos when it comes to exploring creative territory, but it's chaos throughout the whole project. Everyone receives the brief. Strategy and creative happens at the same time. Everyone is involved in the production. And when I say everyone, yes, it's the small team running the client, but it's actually the whole agency as well. It's a true collaboration in the sense of the word tillsammans and how that works. Because we view the agency as maybe a little bit of a lab, and the process more like the one when you came up with penicillin, that was a mistake. And we think that creativity can come from anywhere, and ideas can come from anywhere. It can be a mistake, it can be something old, it can be something new. And to find all the ways to explore that process, you need to be able to invite everyone into the process as well. Whether you're a receptionist, whether you're junior, whether you're senior, you need to be able to have your voice and speak your mind. And we find that organizational models that are top-down or too linear put obstacles in the way of that creativity. So that's why we've chosen to be a blob as opposed to a triangle. In addition to that, our teams are very small. So Chris mentioned the work for Volvo. That team is like 5 or 6 people, no more, who runs the account. So the agency is structured like smaller agencies within the agency. And that small agency is 100% responsible for the client or the clients that they work with. Because we think that if you have a small team, you get your voice heard, and you get to talk directly to the client, you get to have a proper discussion with your clients without having levels of titles standing in the way of that discussion that you need to have. You get to talk to your peers, you get to talk to your coworkers properly, you get to spend time with each other. And then, of course, we do have special disciplines that we bring in when it's needed, but the core team is always around 5 or 6 people because we think that promotes creativity in a good way. So to sum it up, this is the way our culture and the way Forsman is structured. Small teams that are formed around each client, and each team is responsible for running that client. They're responsible for the brief, they're responsible for the strategy, for the creative, and for the output, for everything that team is responsible. And you ask for help within the organization when you need it, but it's up to you to ask for that help. And then we have support functions, like Silla, who's our CEO, or Anna, who's our global chairman. They're at the sort of bottom of, if we were a pyramid, they would be at the bottom of the pyramid, but now we see them more as one of the blobs moving around in the organization that we can yank into the project if we need them for something specific, if we need their help or their advice on anything. But they're not the ones who are talking to the senior people within the clients. That's the client team who's responsible for that. So no hierarchy, and we'll go into that a little bit more. So essentially, you can say that Forsman is a product of Swedish society, where a consensus is the most important thing that rules the culture. And sometimes that is reflected in our work as well. So I'm going to show you a bit of work that almost directly reflects the way we view our culture.
How do we get American travelers to consider Sweden as a holiday destination?
We're not really famous for our great weather, or our vibrant city life, or majestic monuments. But we do have something that's pretty unique. It's called the freedom to roam, and it's a right protected by the law that allows us to sleep and eat and walk pretty much wherever we want, just like in a regular home. So to get people excited about Sweden, we listed the entire country on Airbnb. We welcomed the world to a 100 million acres large accommodation, where people could browse through different listings with panoramic terraces, 100,000 tempered infinity pools, soaring ceilings and a fully stocked kitchen, all free of charge. We spread the word about the initiative in online films. To give people more knowledge, famous Swedes wrote about their experience of having free access to nature. And in other channels, we educated people further about freedom to roam through published articles and interviews with wildlife experts. And the news traveled fast. We had a minimal budget, but the campaign spoke for itself. And people got excited. This person thought it was shit balls. And Gabriel wanted to bring the world's entire population with him. And this guy didn't even know where he was going. But he was going. And he wasn't alone. In the end, people all over the world united over something as simple as an Airbnb listing. And we gave them a new reason to visit Sweden.
So while all this might seem terribly unorganized, and it is, now we have around 800 new coworkers coming into the agency, so we try to formulate the way we think and the way we are and the way we act without putting up a framework that is too tight. So we formed 11 principles, which are quite similar to what Neil was talking about before. So you might look at them as well as principles how we internally are trying to rewire the creative machine and a way to think and approach tasks that we think is the way to go to create creativity that really resonates with people. So I'll go through them. The first one might seem really obvious, which is to always aim for world class. But I've found previously that maybe it isn't actually in agencies, because it takes a lot of work, it takes being stubborn, it takes fighting for ideas, and it takes fighting for strategy sometimes to be able to achieve this. And it also takes being able to say no to clients, clients that don't want to aim for world class with you. And it also takes being able to say, actually, I shouldn't be on this client account, because I can't do this with this client. Or maybe I've been on this account for too long. So we often switch teams. We switch creatives, or we switch strategists, or we switch account directors whenever you feel that you're not able to produce this. And I think this one is a given when you read it like this, but at the same time, you need to remind yourself every day that this is what we go to work for. And it's more important than ever, because as a slide that Neil showed too, people aren't really interested in brands. So the least thing we can do is to give them something to be interested in. And the only way of doing that is to aim for world class every time, we feel. The second one is something that Silla, our Swedish CEO, said a long time ago. And I think this is the number one rule that we kind of live and die by and has been doing for a long time. The only boss is the task itself. Can be applied to pretty much anything that has to do with our culture. At the base of it, it means that we remove any obstacle that keeps us from solving the task in the best way possible. So removing the hierarchy within the organization is actually a consequence of this quote. So that's why we removed the hierarchy and the titles, because we don't have any titles, because it gets in the way of solving the task. Time reports gets in the way of solving the task. 100% of the focus needs to be on how do we solve the problem for this client in the best way possible. And everything that comes in between must be removed. That's how we look at it. So first off, when we get a brief or we get a task from a client, that's how we look at the task. Okay, do we have everything we need to solve this task? Do we need to fix anything before? And then we spend 75% of the time we put into projects talking about what the task actually is. So I would say this is the number one guiding principle in our culture that leads everything we do. And that is closely tied with this principle that the responsibility is yours. We've been touching a little bit upon this before as a result of the organization model, where each little team works like an agency within the agency. So you have five people being responsible for the whole client account and the whole task, no matter what it is. And when you come into the agency, since we don't have titles, you are a planner, or you're an art director, you're a copywriter from day one, and you will always be a copywriter and art director. You will never be anything else. Or you, of course, you'll be more senior, but on your male signature, you will be a copywriter. So from day one, you're entering the agency, you will also be given the responsibility in the same level, no matter how much experience you have. You will be given the same responsibility as everyone else. And it's up to you to also seek help from the organization, because even though you're giving this big task to solve and to handle and take responsibility for, you have 200 coworkers of different seniority, of different expertise, of different experiences that can help you. And that leads us to the next principle. The collective in Forsman & Bodenfors is our creative directors. We don't have any creative directors. We don't have any planning directors. We don't have any other long titles that you can't barely fit into a male foot. We have the collective. And you must seek help from the collective. It's 100% completely okay to fail, but it's never okay to fail alone. You need to fail together. That's the only rule that we have. And it was really difficult, actually, coming into the agency. This was the principle I think I struggled the most with when I came into Forsman, because especially as a planner, you're so used to sort of trying to solve the task and trying to solve the problem with research, and the output is the creative brief. That's kind of your proof, your insight that you solved the problem that you were given. And in Forsman, it doesn't work like that. You have to show your work. That's the rule. So if you don't show whatever you're working on, if you don't show your working progress at a very early stage, people will come find you, and they will ask you what you're working on, and they will force you to show it. Because we have that firm belief that Neanderthals compete and Homo sapiens collaborate, and more brains are better than one or a few. So you need to seek out the help from the collective, because that's when we feel we get the best work produced. But that doesn't happen all by itself, usually. You can encourage people to go ask for help, go show their work, but it's a really scary thing to do, right? It's very personal ideas and strategies. So we have another tool or another principle that helps us with this in our everyday work. And I know Chris talked about not putting ideas on the floor, but that is what we do, literally, actually. We try not to step on them, but sometimes that happens as well. So the floor was founded together with the agency 30 years ago. It's called the floor because there was a space in the office in Gothenburg, which was literally a wooden floor, where you, back in the days, printed out ads and put them on the floor. And then as people walked by, no matter if you're a receptionist or creative or a strategist or account director, you stopped and you looked at the work that was on the floor. And if you took the time to stop, you had to give feedback. So then you put a post-it note or just a quick note somewhere on the ad that was on the floor. So of course now the floor has evolved a little bit. We have a digital format of the floor that is also cross offices, because it takes too long to send and print that to New York and back to get feedback. So we have a digital version. But the floor is still effective. And you ask for the floor literally. You call the floor. So you select a few people, and it's up to you to select people from different disciplines and different experiences and different expertises to come look at your work. And it can be a draft of a strategy, or it can be a choice of music, or it can be a creative idea. It could be just something on a post-it note. And you all gather around that, and you have a discussion around it. So the floor is also tied together to the organizational model, where you have the small core team. and the small team is still responsible for the feedback that they're getting. So you don't have to act on whatever the floor is saying. It's up to the team. So you have to collect the floor, but you don't have to take the input of the floor. That's the number one rule. And what comes with the floor is also that you have to be able to give feedback, which I think was quite difficult also when entering a completely flat and feedback-built collective organization like Forsman is, because you have to be good at it. And I think that's still in practice for me, at least, coming from an organization where we maybe don't collaborate so much, how to formulate feedback, how to be good at it, and how to be constructive about it. Because if you go into a floor session, you need to be constructive. You can never say something is bad or just good. You have to contribute and try to improve whatever is on the floor at the moment. So that's pretty much the only tool I think we have, which is quite a concrete way of doing things. Another principle we had, which I struggled with a little bit too when I came into the agency, is that creative and strategy is one process. So letting go of the creative brief for me was difficult for a while. Now that I don't have it anymore, I feel free. No, but it's still difficult because the creative brief as a planner is your purpose often in many agencies. And in Forsman it isn't, because we don't have them, because there is no one who's going to sign it off because we don't have creative directors. So strategy and creative happens at the same time in Forsman. When we receive a brief from the client, the whole small team is in the session. When we do the research, the whole team is in the research, because there's so few of us, we're only five or six. And when we do the strategy, the whole team is involved. Same thing with the creative and the production. So that took some getting used to, and still is. I'm still trying to get used to it. But there is this firm belief that if we have creatives all the way through in the process, all the way through in the research, when we go out and meet people, when we go out and talk to them, it's as important that the creatives meet the people who they're going to make the ideas for as it is that when planners do. Because traditionally, many planners are responsible for the research phase, where we do maybe interviews or we do focus groups or whatever it could be. And we always try to meet the people we're doing the work for face to face. And the whole team is always involved in doing so because we think that achieves the best results. So here's a planner and a copywriter and also an art director and account director who were traveling APAC for Uber, meeting people, I think, across 8 countries for 8 weeks or something to properly find that human connection that we think we need to produce the work that will resonate with the people we're trying to reach.
Look for the bare necessities, the simple bare necessities. Forget about your worries and your strife. I mean the bare necessities, or Mother Nature's recipes that bring the bare necessities of life. Wherever I wander, wherever I roam, I couldn't be found off my big home. The bees are buzzing in the tree to make some honey just for me. When you look under the rocks and plants and take a glance at the fancy ants, then maybe try a few. The bare necessities of life will come to you. They'll come to you.
So as a result of these, thank you. as a result of these small teams, whether they want to or not, the clients usually get very closely involved with us. Because the team is really small and there is no hierarchy. There is no one talking to each other at a higher boss level. And there is no lower level. Like, the team is small and they're going to talk directly to everyone in the whole organization, whether the client wants to or not. That's how we work. We don't, if they ask to talk to an executive, senior, whatever, blah, blah, creative director, we don't have that. So they're just going to have to accept that you're going to talk to an art director or a copywriter, because they're the ones who's going to produce the work, which leads to a close working relationship with the clients that is sometimes painful. But most of the times when you get through that sort of start phase, it becomes really fruitful. So it's not about co-creating with clients, but it's about co-collaborating with them. Because you have to have that kind of respect for them where they know their organization the best. And usually they also have other stakeholders internally that take some digging into to find out what they actually need and how we can actually help them, not just with communication, but also with their everyday life, which is sometimes more useful than you'd think. But also when you're in that close collaboration with the clients, you earn their trust, right? And then you earn their courage as well. And that's when you get them on board to do this kind of crazy creative solutions that might not always seem logical to a company. But you have to work on it to earn that trust. And you can only do that in the close collaboration that is required. Another thing that we try to remember is to embrace a no-frills approach. So this industry is already filled with lots of bullshit, lots of difficult words. We often try to complicate things rather than simplify things, I find, because somehow we think that's easier to sell. If we can confuse people enough that they don't know what we're saying, maybe they'll buy what we're saying, which is kind of not very logical. So we try to remind ourselves of this every time we do something. Is it so easy that someone who is not within our agency or our industry would understand what we're saying? Otherwise, it's not good enough. And it can be an idea, it can be a strategy, or it can be a production, it doesn't matter. Everything needs to be so simple and so straightforward that everyone can understand it. It can be anything from checking the way you word a presentation to removing two-thirds of something because actually you don't need it. Maybe two slides is enough. Maybe you don't need 200 to explain what you're trying to say. If it's too difficult, it's not good enough. That's the approach we try to have. Something else that has been with Foschmann since we started is the way to look at client tasks from this point of view, which is, can we make the world maybe a little bit better, or are we making it worse? So our clients have strong voices, and we have a lot of clients, which means we're responsible for many voices. And we can try to do something good with them. And that's what we try to remember every day. And good can, of course, mean like doing good for society or sustainability or talking about important important topics. It can be inclusion, it can be diversity. But it can also be choosing to do something that is entertaining rather than boring, or something that is beautiful rather than ugly, you know? So it's about, it goes together with creating world class. So if you look whatever it is that you're producing on this particular task and ask ourselves, is this making the world better? Is it making our industry better? Or is it making it worse? So you sense check yourself towards that whenever you do something, and you try not to lose focus of it. It is difficult because you get worn down. We've all been there. You get worn down when it comes to strategy or creative. But you have to get back up again and try again and again. And I think for us, the collective is our savior. So whenever you get worn down and you feel like you can't get back up again, and you feel like you can't do world class, or actually, fuck it, just this time around, I'm going to make the world a worse place, you can seek help from the collective. Because you have 200 colleagues there to help you. And they will lend you their creative minds whenever you want to restart your own mind and try to focus on this again. But we do try to keep an eye on our briefs from the perspective that, can we actually make the world a better place? Can we raise a topic that needs to be raised? Can we talk about something that people don't want to talk about? Can we drag something into the light that hasn't been dragged into the light before? Something that can actually literally make the world a better place, just to start a conversation around it. And I think this campaign is a good example of when that really happened and that really resonated.
不是小孩子了。把自己嫁出去。你一天不结婚，父亲就不死。
不要任性。
可怜天下父母心啊，挑来挑去的，
还给不合适。多亏你，你给整。哥，你现在已经是剩女了。剩女这个词，给人的感觉就是剩下来的女人。给我的感觉就是说，其实好像25岁以后还不结婚就是剩女了。可能会被别人说，或者被家人催，或者有些社会的压力吧。
所以，孤零回家是压力最大的，因为全部人都会在问你，你都多大了，还没结婚呢？
你年龄也不小啦。他们就可能觉得，就是在中国这个社会，就是一定要结婚，那才是一个完整的女人。
你还在城外的感觉？
以前拉着对象，那就人家已经结婚了。
我个人认为，我不太喜欢人民广场的相亲角。
然后可能都是父母，然后拿了一个女儿或者儿子的介绍，然后放在那边。
收入啊，工作是什么样子的？有没有房子？有没有车子？挂个招商启事给卖出去是那种。
中国中华儿女嘛，就是孝为当先，因为他反正就不结婚肯定是不孝的一种。
以前我总认为我的女儿肯定性格好嘛。
人也不是长得太漂亮，一般嘛，所以到现在还是生下来了。渴望真爱，对我还是很渴望爱情的。赶快把它解决好了算了，你不要太残忍了，对吗？
也许想要放弃，找个自己喜欢的、适合的也挺好。
你说要真正找不到，也是我们老两口一个心病。
就算一个人，就是幸福快乐自信的，然后好好过。后来想开了，就是我说剩女，那我工作强了，现在有女强人嘛，这么一说的话，
直到等到那个对的人，妈妈永远支持你。
对于自己生活这件事，我是很开心的，然后很自由，我也享受一个人的状态。
我女儿很美。
剩女很光荣啊，独立着也应该活得很精彩的，这就是我想。她如果觉得，单身的也蛮好，我们还是会尊重她的。
是优秀的女孩啊，胜兰要努力呀，自信，独立，热爱生活。 不错的一位女性。
The next one has more to do with our recruitment process, where we don't welcome any assholes, and to ensure, because the most important thing when you work at Forsman is that you're a nice person. You need to be nice. You need to be nice to people, you need to be nice to clients, to animals, but you need to be a nice person. And the way we ensure that we only hire nice people is to have a collaborative hiring process, of course. So we don't have any particular person who hires people. It's the agency who hires new people. So when you come into Forsman for interviews, you meet maybe 10 or 12 people at once, in a discussion meeting. So it's not really the traditional recruitment process. And you need to, it's more of a chemistry thing. You need to have chemistry, and you need to be able to show that you're able to collaborate, you're able to listen, you're able to take feedback, you're able to give feedback. All the things that we've been talking about now are things that are being discussed when you come to us, if you're interested to work in a consensus-seeking collective agency. You need to show that that's why you're there. So the whole recruitment process is 100% collaborative. No one is particularly responsible. Everyone is responsible, just as we are for the tasks. And it all boils down to that we are a 100% human workplace. We believe that people need to have the room to be human and make mistakes, take time off from work. To do your best, you need to be allowed to be everything that encompasses your humanity. And that is what Forsman is about. So we have a few things that help people in their everyday life, in the agency, to feel their best. Because we think that if you feel your best, you will be your best, and then you will do your best work, of course. So a few things of those is that we have eight weeks of paid vacation, which in Sweden doesn't really help, but then we can travel maybe. But it's about that even though you like your colleagues and even though you like your workplace, maybe you don't want to spend the whole year with your colleagues. You want to take time off. You want to be with your friends. You want to be with your family. Because if you can, then you will produce better work. That's how we believe in it. If you can find that like inner peace that, okay, I have time to spend with my children. I have time to spend with my husband or my girlfriend. That would make you feel better on the inside, which will make you be better when you're at work, right? So we ensure that people take the time off that they need. So we close the agency as well for a month during the summer. So doors are locked if you're coming to the agency. We collaborate and we help each other. As we talked about, collaboration trumps competition. That's a firm belief that we have. We never compete internally. I know some agencies have junior creatives running along on a brief, trying to sort of chase the creatives who are working on the brief. We don't do that. We'd never do that. You ask for help. We work 9 to 5. The office is usually empty at 5 if there aren't circumstances that are special, like a pitch, for instance, or something. But we encourage people to leave at 5. And in Sweden, we have government-paid daycare, so people can go pick up their kids at 2 or 3, whatever they need. Because you can work remotely as well, of course. So we encourage people to be out of the office. And we have no time reports. So going back to the only boss is the task itself, we found that time reports requires a lot of time. And from my own experience, they do. I could sit for a day trying to catch up on whatever the fuck I did 3 weeks earlier. And that took a lot of time, a lot of energy and a lot of focus from actually trying to solve the things we're trying to solve and from the reason that we are at work every day to produce world-class creative solutions for our clients. So we removed those as well. All with the purpose of encouraging humanity in the workplace and encouraging people to be human and allowing people to make mistakes and allowing people to be themselves, taking time off, being sad, being happy, and supporting each other, I think, in whatever it is that needs to be supported, whether it's a creative solution or whether it's a personal solution. We try to be there for each other, not just as people, but as a way of working and as a culture. Because our belief is that if we can be the best people we can be in our everyday, we can also produce the best work that resonates with humans, right? If we allow ourselves to be humans, we can create solutions that resonate with humans.
Thank you.